Hey everybody, this is Mr. Moppin coming at you again with another APUSH video. This is our third and final video focusing in on topic 7.2, dealing with debates surrounding American imperialism. And previously, we talked about, you know, many of the reasons why the United States wanted to get into imperialism, you know, to make more money, to spread, you know, American waspish cultural values, to have a very respected military, a desire to have a new frontier, you know, to reestablish oneself. And of course, you know, we start to see some of that being manifested, for example, in, you know, the acquisition of Hawaii, just as one example. But note that, you know, as America is starting to get some of this sense of imperialism fever, not everybody's going to be on board with this. There's going to be some folks that are going to be a little squeamish about this, and downright in opposition to it. You're going to have some folks such as, you know, politicians like William Jennings Bryan, to cultural figures such as Mark Twain, that are going to be in agreement. Even Andrew Carnegie, in many respects, is going to be opposed to this idea of what's going to become American imperialism. And one of those key reasons, and, you know, in fact, perhaps the best reason is that, you know, when you talk about creating a global empire, which is imperialism, this is what, you know, imperialism is all about, you have to take over other people's territory, which means that by definition, you are taking away their freedom. You're taking away their independence. You're taking away their sovereignty. Well, if America is going to be doing this, then that's certainly going to be a departure on what had been traditional American values. Remember, America exists because we refuse to accept some other power tyrannizing us and denying us of our basic rights. Well, if it was not acceptable for Britain to treat us as colonies, how can we then go and turn around and make other people our colonists? You know, how does that square? And for many, it doesn't square, that you are clearly abandoning American ideals. You are denying people their self-determination. You're denying them their independence. Another key argument against it is that, you know, this is especially against the cultural component for going into imperialism, is that, you know, this is a racist policy, that, you know, if you are going to some place, you know, and say, no, your native faith is illegitimate, no, your native dress is inappropriate, your history doesn't matter, then that's some pretty racist stuff, that, you know, simply because you're of a different skin color, or you're of a different ethnicity, that you don't come from Europe, if you will, that you don't matter, that your history doesn't matter, your values don't matter, your culture doesn't matter. That's pretty racist stuff. So there's going to be a lot of opposition on that level. From more of a political standpoint, there's going to be opposition to imperialism, because there's going to be a concern that this is going to be going against one of President Washington's key pieces of advice from his famous farewell address near the end of his presidency. And in addition to, you know, warring against factions, you know, aka, you know, political parties, there's also going to be a strong recommendation that America stay isolationist. You know, stay in our neck of the woods, focus on internal matters. You know, we don't want to get ourselves into situations on the global stage where we come up against major powers and as a result, you know, lose our independence. And so the argument being is that that's, you know, helped us out. That's worked out pretty darn well for us for, you know, going on a century now. And, you know, why do we want to abandon that? You know, why risk, you know, getting America into wars when we don't have to? Yes, granted, we're not the small, you know, agrarian experiment that we were a century earlier. Yes, we're a mighty economic power. And yes, we have a bigger military. And, you know, all that's true. But at the same time, though, part of why we've been able to enjoy that success is that we've avoided wars with major powers for the most part. So why get into some sort of a competition with the major powers over colonies that might create future wars? And then lastly, you know, if you are trying to maintain some sort of a global empire, then that's going to require a bigger military. And that bigger military is going to require a bigger government, which means it's going to require more money. And so for many folks that, you know, had enjoyed the fact that America has had a pretty small government relatively speaking, historically, this would change all that. That you would have to, you know, significantly have to do things like raise tariffs to bring in more income, or even, you know, create an income tax, you know, something along those lines to bring in revenue to fund this built-up military as part of our growing empire. So there's certainly going to be some folks with, you know, economic, political, cultural reasons for why imperialism should not be happening for the United States. But for that camp, they're going to be outnumbered considerably during this time period. Yes, there's going to be some voices of opposition, but for the most part, Americans are going to be in support of imperialism, and government's going to be pretty much full steam ahead on this. So we'll go ahead and finish that here for now, and we'll take a look at how this is going to be manifesting, this thing called imperialism is going to be manifesting into a future conflict with Spain by the end of the century. But once again, we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.